Accountability and Csuite Xchange podcast. I'm Teddy. Today we have the honor to have Mr. Zen Liow come to share with us his own vision and value.
Thank you.
What is that?
Thanks for having me, Teddy.
Oh, it's our pleasure. So, have you followed what is the business like with dumb people? So is people the most important element in your company that you need to drive your business success?
Yeah, absolutely. We've got lots of people in our company.
Yeah, I heard that you have over 200,000 people in your globe, right?
Yes.
So how to manage these people? How do you choose these people? What kind of talent you need from these people?
For the people that we choose, the primary criteria is experience, no surprise. But the second criteria is more pertinent to our culture. So we emphasize a lot about our culture. So when we look at a person, this person may be really qualified, but if the culture, if the personality of the person does not suit our culture, we would either let him or her go.
Oh. Can you describe a little bit of your culture?
Yeah.
If I want to apply to your company, what kind of attributes I should have before you can take me?
Yeah, we got a set of cultures that we adhere to. The first being the fanatical about clients and people. That is the number one culture that we have in the company. We also look at people whether they have contrarian view. So we prefer people who say, okay, look, is this the only way to do things? Is there a different way out of the box thinking on how you go about in doing the same thing the same way?
Right.
So that rely heavily on how we select the people.
Okay, that's great. So you need some people have some views, right?
Yeah.
And at the same time, you have the alignment of the vision.
Yes, because the culture is how we guide all our people. Because policy is on paper, it's writing, it depends on how you interpret it. But the culture, if everybody is adhered to the culture, at least we do the same thing, different thing the same way to the same result.
Right.
That's important.
I like your work on contrarian. Okay. Can you share with me some example? If one of your employees really contrarian, right? Always challenging you.
Yeah.
So what do you do? Or what did you do?
Well, challenge is fine. So I think in all discussion, we always talk about, okay, what do you think?
Right.
Well, the first thing is we gotta accept different people with different ideas, or else there's no point discussing.
Exactly, yes.
Right. So in a lot of times, obviously, if their ideas are totally different from what a company has, the first thing we do is we have to really listen and say, why do you have such diverse ideas that are so different? Obviously, the first thing is to listen. That's the most important.
Okay.
Then it will be a decision time where we look at whether we can implement the idea. For example, in our company, we have built a global platform called Root, R-O-O-T-S.
Okay.
Well, this platform actually takes all the ideas from everyone that wants to contribute. It's an online platform. Anybody, anywhere, anytime can just go in and log in ideas. The ideas can be totally different, can be supplement to what we have, and the ideas will come to a central party where the parties will evaluate, review, and if agree, execute the idea.
Oh, that's great.
So if we imagine if 10% of the people have 20,000 ideas,
right?
So that's humongous, how we can leverage the ideas.
Well, that's tremendous, right?
Yeah.
A lot of ideas coming from your front line.
Yes.
So, is there any special reason that you call it Root or Roots?
There is an acronym to that.
Okay.
That's a very long acronym. But the gist of that is we have to, as you say, we go to the front line, right?
Yes.
Because they are the one doing the work.
Right.
So they know what are the difficulties. They speak to the clients. So they understand what the client's looking for, the client's challenges. So they are the root for everything. Right?
Oh,
so,
wonderful. That's great. From that obsession.
Yes.
Make sure that in front line, when you touch the customer. Customer come first.
Yes.
Employees also come first.
Correct. That's the first culture statement. Fanatical about the clients and the people.
Right,
so we need to hear what they say.
So apart from having that root system here, how do you build ambient that people can speak? I mean, they are not aware of any resistance or pressure or whatsoever. They are very free to speak up and try to express what they think. How do you give that kind of safe environment for people to do that? How do you do that?
Yeah, that's very difficult.
Yeah, exactly. Because I mean, employee tends not to speak too much, right? Rather than pick on.
Yes.
So how do you give a very good environment to people that can speak up?
Yeah, they are in our company. They are direct and indirect.
Okay.
The direct will be we have an open door policy,
right.
So you can go in and speak to your managers or speak to anybody. You can also go and speak to we call it skip level.
Right.
So my team member can skip level
right.
from me and go straight to my boss,
okay.
right to speak. So that is more direct.
Right.
The indirect is we do have an email address where anybody who wants to escalate anything.
Oh, that's a whistleblower email address then.
Yeah, like a whistleblower, like anything that you want to highlight that you don't want anybody else or direct people to know.
Can you do it anonymously or it must be in person name?
Right now we are doing in person name.
Okay.
Because the last thing we want is this is just rumors and nobody wants to take
okay.
responsibility or accountability.
Right.
The third thing that we do is on a yearly basis, we do a 360 degree survey.
Okay.
It is an official survey, a set of questions
right.
sent to the people.
Right.
So it's 360. So there's a survey that for the employees to fill out to say, hey, how happy am I on a set of things?
Uh-huh.
There's another survey to survey the bosses.
Oh, wow.
So we say,
it's
hey,
kind of checking, right?
Yes, yes. So it's
the boss will be under very big pressure.
Just a little bit. So we go and say, hey, how good is your bosses in different ways?
Okay.
So it is fairly detailed.
Okay.
For those surveys are anonymous.
Okay.
So obviously.
So why don't you share with us how about your result? Do you have any somebody complaining?
It's coming out hopefully. We just finished the survey recently.
Okay.
The 360 just survey recently. Uh-huh. Yeah, so maybe we'll get a result in next month or two.
Wow, so you were expecting something really, more challenging to yourself, would it?
It's always good to know frank opinion.
Yes. Frank and direct opinion is good,
yeah.
constructive.
Yes, so that's what I do with my team, right?
Wow.
So if anything, let's go straight, you know, let's not play any politics, let's
sure.
not go behind
what
the ball.
That's waste of
let's
time.
Go straight, yes.
Exactly, to the business, to the customer, right?
Correct.
So apart from employees, how do you collect customer voices as well?
Very interesting. So in our business, we do there are a few stages. When we first implement a program, or you build a complex, right?
Okay.
During the process, we will do a survey
okay.
on how the implementation has gone.
Mm-hmm.
Has it gone well? What has not gone well? And how can we improve?
Okay.
After the implementation of the program, on a quarterly basis.
Quarterly.
Yeah, we would have what we call a customer survey, official
okay.
survey. Official set of questions that the client can rate us
right.
from how happy they are on different things
okay.
and things for comment. So every quarter they will get either email survey or face-to-face survey.
Wow.
So yeah, it's intense.
Intense. Your team must be very big. I mean, do we discuss statistics then?
Yeah, we have a team that does that globally and,
mm-hmm.
and regionally. We also use our voice of customers platform where we have a system just like the roots.
Yeah.
So we have a technology platform that gather feedback.
Right, that's
and,
great.
Yeah, after the gathering the feedback, it's more about analytics, right? So
yeah.
I think the Southern University have their data science. So,
right.
so we have a big data team that analyze what the clients are saying before saying, okay, so how do we intend to fix this?
Exactly.
So
well, that's the basis for innovation then.
Yes.
So can you share with us some of the big innovation you can derive from because of the voices in the business team? Any examples that can demonstrate to the audience that maybe collecting customer voice is very important towards your sustainability and growth?
The customer voice, a lot of that is on operation side, on how we improve. So it could be whether we do more about the analytics or the data.
Right.
Right. How further we can improve. It could be also on the people. There are many examples on how they like them to be managed.
Right.
Right. But there are a few results that come out with that. So on the recent COVID 19, for example, there were voices from customers to say, hey look, you run my critical operation and nobody can come to work, then what do we do? Right? So
right.
so we mobilize our work at home fairly immediately. During that COVID-19 period, 90% of our people in different regions work from home.
Wow.
And this is this very sizable team, right? So
exactly.
There are thousands and thousands of people working from home. then we hear the voices on, okay, because that is an emergency, so that is fine. But how about long term? Can we do work at home for long term? And they are accessing our clients' critical data. How do we make sure it's secure? Right? We hear that voices, then we say, okay. So we created a new system called Secure CX.
Okay.
Well, this Secure CX essentially is, imagine you're in front of your laptop.
Right.
This particular software can actually do a biometrics on you.
Okay.
You can say, okay, Zen, are you supposed to work today? All right. Are you supposed to be on leave? So if you're supposed to work today, the biometric would say yes, approve. Right. Just like your face prints on your phone.
Right.
And you can also tell, because we're dealing with a lot of sensitive data, if I'm putting a phone in front of my laptop,
yeah,
you can tell to say there's a phone, it will cut off your access.
Wow. That's AI then, right?
Yes.
Wow.
And if,
interesting, right?
Yeah, if Teddy comes to me and stand beside me and looking at my laptop,
peeping
all my family members who work at home, right? And it will cut off.
Wow.
So
that's sanitary, isn't it?
Yes, it's a very intelligent platform that we have created for facilitating work at home. Then the intention then is client will be a lot more comfortable, right, to execute work at home. We don't know how this thing is going to last. We don't know whether people will actually eventually go back to work in the office, right? So a lot of people will still continue to work from home.
Yeah, I mean, I think maybe work from home is another, or mobile working is another trend, right? Despite the COVID may be going.
Correct.
So in that case, will company permanently change your behavior so that people can actually work anywhere?
Yeah, we have been doing that. So even in our management team, globally, regionally, all of us don't work in the same location. And we work like remotely for many, many years already. So this is not new to us.
Okay.
But for the frontline teammates, this probably is new to them, right? But we are anticipating a fair portion of our people will continue to work permanently at home.
Okay.
And we have also created a freelance platform called SOLV, S-O-L-V, SOLV, where these are for freelance. And as you can imagine, freelance work from anywhere they want.
Surely.
It could be in a coffee shop, it could be in a cinema where they just help to answer the client's questions.
Right.
So we more or less promote the flexibility for people to work anywhere they want to support clients.
It's so fantastic, right? Amazing. Yeah. I can't really think about it. I mean, people just maybe walking by and then just a pip, right? And then that's stop, right?
Yeah.
So the data is contained.
Yes, the Secure CX will detect it and just cut off your access.
Wow, that's fantastic.
It will be a report triggered to the manager and say, hey, look, potential breach from this person.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
So apart from working on offsite, right? Mm-hmm. Any sort of RPA, robotic process automation you want to bring in during this COVID period so that people can actually eliminate a bit of the amount more manpower, try to automatic anything.
Yeah.
Make it automatic. How to do it? Or have you an example of ensuring people that, machine can replace a lot of mundane work?
Yeah, there are a few things that we hear from clients during this period. We have been hearing a little bit of that, but it was especially strong during this period. The first is client was looking for self-service, right? Because nobody can go to work.
Sure.
So they have been driving a lot of self-service. Now, how do we do that?
Okay.
The second portion is, now that COVID is underway for a bit of time, to your point, I need more sales. I need to collect my debt faster.
Right.
I need to reduce my cost, but I still need to take care of my customers.
Okay.
Right. So there are two portions to that. So the self-service part, what we have proposed and promote to our customers, we have a set of self-service engine, navigation system. So we are technology-enabled services company. So we have the normal chatbots, but we upgrade it to a little bit to become a multilingual chatbot.
Wow, fantastic.
Yeah, so it does the automatic translation.
Yep.
So imagine that in the future, maybe Cantonese, we can support out of India.
Well, in fact, we have changes, right? Part Chinese, part English, right? Part Mandarin, right?
Yeah, so we have three languages in one sentence.
Exactly. So,
right.
Your machine is very clever.
Yeah. So the multilingual translation engine is first started. It will be for a direct language. It's pretty proficient, about 85-90%. For the multiple languages in one sentence, like probably you and I used to do, it will take time to adjust because it's learning about the language as we go. But ultimately, in a few years' time, can we do it? Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Yeah. So we call it the lingua app. So that's something new that we're bringing to the table to reduce the customer's cost.
Okay.
All right. So imagine I don't need to support Cantonese from Hong Kong or China or Malaysia. Imagine support from India, from Indonesia, right, who don't even speak the language, right, using the auto translation. Then we also, on the self-service side, we obviously have our own intelligent IVR. That's the simple one where instead of 1, 2, 3, you just say what you want, it will give you the answer.
Right.
We have a team that does mobile apps.
Okay.
Right? So mobile app is a perfect self-service.
Yep.
Right? Who wants to call, right? So just find the answer on the apps.
Exactly.
So we have a big team that does the apps for some of the big companies in the world. So that's the self-service that we're putting together to let clients use them, right? Intention is to continue to support the customers during any time of the day and reduce cost.
Okay.
Right. The cost can be significant, like 20-30% reduction.
Really?
Yes.
So my role will be, a third thing, right? I mean, we cut off because of you, right?
I think the role will change.
Yeah.
The role will be more about, okay, from Teddy's point of view, what is the strategy that you want?
Yeah.
What is the design that you want? What is the customer journey that you want the customer to go through?
Exactly.
For this, we still need people like you, the expert in this field, to say, okay, this is the experience that I want my clients to have.
Okay.
Then we will work
with you.
It is true. Then we will work with you and how to make your mission and your vision come true.
Okay.
And execute it. Right.
Yes,
so
exactly.
So that's the main thing. So we work with you, we execute it,
okay.
We guarantee the results.
Right.
We don't walk away after we talk.
So during COVID, do you see it's a chance or as a threat? I mean, to your company, it seems to me you're having more opportunity after COVID.
That's a very, very interesting question. So during the good days, client will come to us and say, how can I take care of my customer better? You know, they will say, how do I drive more revenue? Not so much on reduced cost because they are growing. And not so much on collect faster because they have so much revenue.
Right.
During the not so good time, client will come to us and say, okay, Zen, I need to help me to drive up more revenue.
Right.
Can you help me to do some analytics on where the opportunities are? Or who can I sell more rather than I have a blast to everybody else?
Okay.
They'll come to us on that. During this time, they'll come to us and say, I've sold so much things. How do I collect the money faster?
Okay.
Okay. A few days faster, meaning the cash flow is there. If come back, I can reinvest. Obviously, the cost reduction and taking care of customers are still there. So yes, this service outsourcing industry is more or less blessed. You know,
right.
We can work well during good times and we can work well during not so good times.
Well, it seems to me that you're not just doing service and support. Mm-hmm. You're doing innovation for the customer.
Yeah, we do. That's the
you're giving
way.
Them advice as well, right?
Yes, we do.
Well, you're taking a lot of business out of it.
We hope so.
That's great. So, would you mind recommend a book to our audience? What book you think? I mean, the best one to advise to a customer. I mean, to our audience, look into how to be so fast, right?
Yeah, I have to confess, I don't read a lot of physical books anymore because lot of things that I read are online.
Okay.
Because a lot faster.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
More updated, but the last book that I really like is the book on Robert Ball.
Okay.
The chairman of Caris and Shangri-La. Well, first thing is, well, it's fellow Malaysian.
Okay.
He's a very, very respected Malaysian, so I respect him a lot. I really like that book because he talked about how he built something out of nothing. You know, how he built it and lost it and built again. The journey that he went through was just amazing.
Well, that's entrepreneur.
Yes, that's amazing. I mean, not many people can do that.
Okay.
People can build and then drop and then that's it, right?
Right. Persistence, right? Perseverance,
yes.
Right?
Yes, yes. And how he has built that was just amazing. How he has gone through the different era, the Japanese occupation,
right.
The
ups and downs, right?
The Malaysian politics has gone through. It was just amazing.
Right.
So, I really learned the resilience from him.
Okay.
Right. You know, thinking out of the box, and as you said, never give up. The persistence is on that. That was just amazing. So I would really recommend the Robert Quark, the memoir of Robert Quark.
Wow.
It's been out for a bit, but. No, even my 12-year-old son read it. So
right,
he said,
right.
That's interesting.
Yeah, of course, right? We all read it from those wisdom people, right?
Yes, yes.
And stand on the shoulder to get higher and higher.
Yes, yeah. And it's closer to reality.
Okay.
Because it's a real person that we I mean, I don't know him personally, but we have heard about him for a long time. It sounded more real rather than someone who's very far away, a very long time ago. So it's more real.
Thank you, Zen. You learn from Robert, I learn from you.
Oh, no.
Thank you so
from
much.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You for coming.
Thank you for your time
Thank you.
Today.
Thank you.